هيا على الفلاح.
Naturally, when you speak about Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, what's the first thing that comes to your mind? His shyness, and with his shyness, with his haya, comes shyness, softness, modesty, humility. The other defining feature that you have about him is his generosity. Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu, he says, I once saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam raising his hands from the beginning of the night until the end of the night, saying, Oh Allah, I am pleased with Uthman, so be pleased with him.
When the Prophet alayhi wasallam asked for military equipment for a battle, Uthman ibn Affan, he didn't give used items. He gave what we would be an equivalent of today, fully loaded Humvees. He brought the best camels. He brought the best shields and swords. If it wasn't for the love of Allah, what was it for? Such was the love that he had for him.
In the time of Umar ibn Khattab, there was peace and security and there was stability. After Umar ibn Khattab passed away, that's when the fitan started. Then Uthman ibn Affan became the Khalifa. Uthman ibn Affan was killed, was assassinated. The difference between the assassination of Umar and Uthman is that the assassination of Umar was done by a disbeliever. But the assassination of Uthman was done by people under the name of Islam. And that's why it opened the door of this unity.
And Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, because of his leniency, does not act harshly towards them. And he says, I do not want a single drop of blood being shed in my cause. But still with that, Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu places his children, Al-Hasan wal-Husayn, to guard Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. On that day of Thursday, July 16th, Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, while he's reading Qur'an, and he's sitting down, this 82-year-old man, he dozes off and he falls asleep at the time of Salatul Asr. And he was fasting that day, and he sees in his dream, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, smiling. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, Ya Uthman, did they forbid you from water? And he said, Na'am, Ya Rasulullah. And he said, Ya Uthman, did they forbid you from food? And he said, Na'am, Ya Rasulullah, they forbade me from food. And he said, Ya Uthman, did they forbid you from praying salah in my masjid? And he said, Na'am, Ya Rasulullah, they forbade me from praying salah in your masjid. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to him, Good news, O Uthman, you're going to break your fast with us tonight. Subhanallah.
Abu Bakr was soft and compassionate, very social. Umar ibn Khattab was stern and firm. Uthman ibn Affan represents shyness. Ali ibn Abi Talib represents the warrior.
First and foremost, when we speak about Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, just to kind of give you a picture of who we're looking at, we're talking about the person that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says to his daughter Kulthum radiallahu anha, who would be the wife of Uthman, that no man resembles more in physical appearance your father Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and your grandfather Ibrahim alayhi salam more than Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. When you read his description, that he was not too tall, not too short, that he had long curly black hair, a touch of redness to his face, broad shoulders, and a small gap between his teeth, these are the descriptions of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he was so beautiful that Abdurrahman ibn Hazm radiallahu anhu, he says, I have never seen a man more beautiful in my life than Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Extremely handsome, extremely modest, to the point that it was said about him by in the narration of Al-Hasan radiallahu ta'ala anhu, even when he's changing his clothes behind closed doors, he feels a sense of shyness. That when he gave bay'ah to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam with his right hand, he refused to ever use that right hand to touch his private parts again after that. That he was so humble in his talk, so modest and soft-spoken, that you would have to come so close to him just to hear what he was trying to tell you. So he didn't have a commanding voice, he had a very soft voice. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who was known for his bashfulness, known for his haya, admired Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu to the point that Aisha radiallahu anha narrates an incident that once the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam was sitting down and he was reclining and part of his thigh was exposed sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu walked in, he sat with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam did not sit up, he spoke with him, he left. Umar came in, he sat with the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he spoke with him and then he left. And then Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu sought permission to come in. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam sat up and he covered himself and he made sure that he was proper. And Aisha radiallahu anha says, Ya Rasulullah, we know that Abu Bakr and Umar are more virtuous than Uthman. How come when they came in, you didn't sit up, you didn't fix yourself or anything in that regard, but when Uthman came in, you fixed yourself in that way? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said the very famous statement, shouldn't I be ashamed or shy from a man who even the angels are shy in his presence? What you always find is that when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam would call people to give sadaqah, Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu was always one of the first to come forward. To the point in Ghazwa Tabuk, Uthman radiallahu anhu came forward with more than what the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam was asking for. 100 camels became 200, became 300, until they became 1,000. And Uthman radiallahu anhu keeps on putting that forward. And Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu then goes and brings 1,000 gold coins and puts that in the lap of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam is counting those coins and he's taking it between his fingers and he's saying, nothing will harm Uthman radiallahu anhu after this day. You can do whatever you want, nothing will harm you today. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forgiven you today. The other incident which he's famous for, which is purchasing the well of Rumah, which was a well that was owned by one of the Jews of Medina that was placed in a strategic position, especially for Badr. Uthman radiallahu anhu was the one who bought that. Uthman radiallahu anhu was the one who financed the expansion of the masjid. Every time you have a door of sadaqah, he was foremost in that. Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu sought the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam went out of his way to show Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu that he loved him. And for that reason, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam's two daughters, first you see Ruqayya radiallahu ta'ala anha, who was married to who? Utbah, the son of Abu Lahab. And who was Kulthum, his other daughter, married to? Utaybah, the son of Abu Lahab. And obviously when Islam came, these two women were left divorced. Fatima radiallahu anha was still very young. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam marries to Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, his daughter Ruqayya radiallahu anha. Ruqayya radiallahu anha was also known for her modesty. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam pairs these two together. And from that relationship, you have a son, Abdullah ibn Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Now I want you to think about this. Everything is going as well as it could possibly go. And then Ruqayya radiallahu anha gets sick. All of a sudden, she's taken by a fever. Only days before Badr, and on the same day that the Muslims are given the victory of Badr, Ruqayya radiallahu ta'ala anha passes away. The day of great joy and the day of great sadness. And then to add to that pain, just a short time afterwards, Abdullah, his son, is walking and he is pecked in the face by a bird and he's infected and he dies too. And Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu was so depressed, obviously. I mean, he lost his wife and his child just like that. And it got to the point that Uthman would come to the salah. He would not neglect his prayer, he would not neglect those things, but he would avoid communication with people. And this hurt the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He wanted to show Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu how much he loves him. So he goes to Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu and he says, what's wrong with you, O Uthman? What's making you so depressed? And Uthman radiallahu anhu answers with the obvious first, obviously the death of Ruqayya, but he says the death of Ruqayya and then something else. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, what is that, Ya Uthman? My relationship with you, my kinship with you was severed by her death. But you want to know how truthful he was in that statement? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, Jibreel alayhi salam came to me with an order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to marry my other daughter, Kulthum radiallahu anha, to him with the same dowry. Subhanallah. And that's where he gets the nickname, the Nurain, the possessor of two lights. He was distinguished in marrying two daughters of the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. 6 years later, she passes away too. And Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu once again is sad. And listen to how much the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam loves him. He says to Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he says, Wallahi, if I had 40 daughters, I would marry each and every single one of them to you until each and every single one of them would die and I would be left with no daughters. You can only imagine how it was like when he passed away sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was so much so that Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, people thought that he lost his ability to speak. He was so taken aback by the death of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he no longer was able to speak. In the khilaf of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and I fast forward through all the conquests, and I fast forward through the first 10 years of contribution, and we go to his moment of adversity. We go to the fitna that was caused in this ummah from one man, Abdullah ibn Saba, who was financed from the outside to cause division within the Muslim ummah, and who started his division, who started his fitna with going to Kufa and Iraq and asking questions here and there, trying to shake people's faith. And you have these people, this fitna rising from all the corners of the Muslim world. And Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, because of his leniency, does not act harshly towards them, but instead he replaces governors as they request. And he acts towards them with softness until they finally lay the house of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu under siege. And for this ordeal of over 40 days, Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, who at that point was 82 years old, would be forbidden water from the same well that he purchased for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, would be forbidden to pray in the same masjid that he financed its expansion, the masjid of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, would be treated in the most humiliating manner. And this is something that the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in many different ahadith, he warned Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu that this would happen. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, O Uthman, perhaps Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shall clothe you with a garment, and if the hypocrites demand that you remove it, do not remove it until you meet me. Do not take off a garment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala placed upon you. And what was Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam talking about? He was talking about the Khilafah. In many different incidents, in one that was narrated from Ubay radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that once the Sahaba were sitting in Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, was wrapped up in a garment. His face was wrapped. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that this man will be upon truth and guidance and he will be killed because he will refuse to take off a garment which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed upon him. And whenever he removed his face wrap, it was Uthman radiallahu anhu. Perhaps the most heart-wrenching incident of all. Aisha radiallahu anha says, and this is in Ahmad, an authentic hadith, that once the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam told Uthman radiallahu anhu, come close. And he started to whisper into his ear. As he would whisper into his ear, Uthman radiallahu anhu would move away and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would say, did you understand? And Uthman radiallahu anhu would say, yes. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would say, come close. And he would keep on whispering in his ear until the face of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu started to change colors. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam kept on telling him, did you understand? He said, na'am ya Rasulullah, I understood, O Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so when this fitna comes, I just want to mention the incidents that Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu goes through, in which he prohibits the Sahaba from fighting on his behalf, and he says, I do not want a single drop of blood being shed in my cause. But still with that, Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu places his children, Al-Hasan wal-Husayn, to guard Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. Al-Zubayr radiallahu ta'ala anhu places his son Abdullah ibn Zubayr. So the children of the greatest Sahaba are guarding Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and Uthman is telling them, do not shed a drop of blood in my cause. Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu is begging him that we have to foil this fitna, we have to foil this plot, and he's consistently refusing. And we saw the rudeness, the harsh hearts that these people had when they treated Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu worse than a prisoner would be treated. And they started to come closer and closer on his house, and they set his gate on fire. And one man jumps into the back of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu's house, and he says, "Leave it and we will leave you." And Uthman radiallahu anhu wanted to leave the Khilafah, but he was reminded by Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, "Do not take off a garment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed upon you." And Uthman radiallahu anhu says to that man, "Woe to you, wallahi, I have never uncovered a woman in Jahiliyyah. There's women in this house, I'm not the only one in this house." And that man became ashamed, and he left the fitna, and he sought forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the next incident that takes place is they started to throw stones in the house of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And they started to try to pelt him with those stones. And Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he stands out, he says outside of his window, "Don't you know that in this house there are others than me, and you might harm them?" And look at the level that these people reached. They said, "We didn't throw the stones at you." They said, "Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala threw them at you." And he said to him, "May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala disgrace you. You are a liar, because if Allah threw a stone at me, he wouldn't have missed." And that person left the fitna and he sought forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the people of fitna started to say, "Alaqna," he suspended us, wallah. He put us in a situation that we're not able to do anything to him. Then they started to decide upon who would murder him. So first they send in a man, and he comes to Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he raises his sword right in the face of Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu says, "Where are you from?" And he says, "Banu Layth." Uthman radiallahu anhu said, "You're not the one." And he said, "Why?" He said, "Because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made dua for your tribe." That man puts down his sword and he runs away and he seeks forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Next, another man is sent in to kill Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And he stands in front of him, right about to strike him, and Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu says, "You're not the one. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam made dua for your tribe. It's not going to be you." And then that man runs away and he seeks forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The person who used to stand in night and qiyam, that was about Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And the one who used to keep the habit of fasting even in his old age. On that day of Thursday, July 16th, Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, while he's reading Qur'an, and he's sitting down, this 82-year-old man, he dozes off and he falls asleep at the time of Salatul Asr. And he was fasting that day because it's the day of Thursday, and that was the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he sees in his dream Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam standing in front of him, smiling. And behind him is Abu Bakr and Umar radiallahu anhumah. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, "Ya Uthman, did they forbid you from water?" And he said, "Na'am ya Rasulullah." And he said, "Ya Uthman, did they forbid you from food?" And he said, "Na'am ya Rasulullah, they forbade me from food." And he said, "Ya Uthman, did they forbid you from praying salah in my masjid?" And he said, "Na'am ya Rasulullah, they forbade me from praying salah in your masjid." And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam then says to Uthman radiallahu anhu, the one who he loved so much to the point that he spent a whole night making dua for his pleasure, the one who Uthman radiallahu anhu became mute at his death, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam says to him, "Good news, O Uthman, سوف تفطر عندنا هذه الليلة." You're going to break your fast with us tonight. Subhanallah. And the people around Uthman radiallahu anhu, they see Al-Hasan wal-Husayn and the women in his household, they see the tears coming down his eyes. And he wakes up full of joy. This was the goal of these men. And he relates his dream to the people. No sooner does he narrate his dream to his wife Naila radiallahu anha and Al-Hasan wal-Husayn and those who are around him, except that they storm the house. And as they storm the house and they stand in front of him, Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu was sitting down, 82 years old, reading Surah Al-Baqarah and not paying any attention to them. And the people take a moment and they stop. They look at him and they don't know what to do. Look at this man and his khushu'. How could we kill this man? Until Al-Ghafiqi, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala curse him, strikes Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu in the face with a piece of iron. And the blood comes running down. And it falls on the ayah, فَسَيَكْفِيكَهُمُ اللَّهُ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will suffice for you against them. And Allah is the all-hearing and the all-knowing. Muhammad ibn Abi Bakr, who was caught up in the fitna, comes to Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And he grabs his beard, about to strike him. And Uthman radiallahu anhu says, let go of my beard because your father used to honor it. When I meet your father in Jannah, I don't want to tell him that you were the one who killed me.
قيم تسمو بها نحو العلا.
And then these rebels, they came and they struck Uthman radiallahu anhu on the head with a piece of iron. And the blood began to pour from the head of Uthman radiallahu anhu. And the first place where the blood fell was on the Quran. And where on the Quran, on the verse, سَيَكْفِيكَهُمُ اللَّهُ, that Allah will suffice you against them. And then one of them was about to strike him with a sword. And Uthman radiallahu anhu placed his hand high to protect himself. And he cut the hand of Uthman radiallahu anhu. And Uthman radiallahu anhu, wallahi, said, I swear by Allah, the hand that you have just cut off, it was the first hand to write the Quran. And then they placed the sword on the stomach of Uthman radiallahu anhu. And his wife, she came running. And she placed her hand between the sword and they cut off the finger of his wife. And then they pierced the stomach of Uthman radiallahu anhu. And after Uthman radiallahu anhu, an 82-year-old man had passed away, one of the rebels, he jumped onto the chest of Uthman radiallahu anhu. And he stabbed him 6 times. And he would say later, I stabbed him 3 times for the sake of Allah and 3 times for myself. And then they dragged the body of Uthman radiallahu anhu to the rubbish tip. And his wife Naila radiallahu anha mentioned that his face was covered with blood. And I went into the house to find if there was anything I could cover his face with, but they had burnt everything. And then I took off my scarf and I placed it on his head. I placed it over his face. And all of a sudden I saw a person running in. And he was came in hurriedly, and I thought that this man will maybe assist us. And he removed the cloth from the man who had passed away, who was the son-in-law of the Prophet ﷺ twice over. And he removed the cloth and he slapped him upon his face. And their rebels were saying, no man can bury Uthman radiallahu anhu. And the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Umm Habiba radiallahu anha, she climbed onto the stairs of the Masjid Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And she said, oh rebels, no, if you do not allow us to bury Uthman radiallahu anhu, then I, the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I, the widow of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I, the beloved of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I, the mother of the believers, will descend into the streets of Medina with my hair uncovered, and I will bury Uthman myself. And when the rebels heard the threat of the wife of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they allowed the body of Uthman radiallahu anhu to be buried by 4 people. Hassan radiallahu anhu, Husayn, Ali radiallahu anhu, and Muhammad ibn Talha. And when they were taking the body of Uthman radiallahu anhu to have it buried, the rebels began to throw rocks. They began to throw rocks at the body of Uthman radiallahu anhu. And then they wanted to bury him in Jannatul Baqi, but the rebels insisted that he be buried outside Jannatul Baqi. Although today his body is inside Jannatul Baqi. And a famous tabi'een called Amrata bin Arta radiallahu anha mentions that when me and Aisha radiallahu anha came back from Hajj, She says, I saw this Quran and I saw the blood over the ayah. Sayakfikahum Allah. That Allah will be sufficient for you against them. And she swears by Allah that each one of these rebels died a disastrous death. Every single one of these rebels died a terrible death. Upon occasion, Abdullah ibn Mubarak rahmatullah alayh was doing tawaf around the Kaaba, and he saw a person holding onto the Kaaba, and he was saying, Oh Allah, forgive me! Oh Allah, forgive me! But I swear that you will not forgive me. And Abdullah ibn Mubarak was astonished by this person's dua. And he said, Who are you? And he said, I am that person who struck the head of Uthman radiallahu anhu with the iron rod. And see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has disfigured my hand. And Abdullah ibn Mubarak kicked him. And he said, Go away, for you are the worst of people. Abu Musa Ashari radiallahu anhu mentions that I came back from Sham. And I saw a group of people outside the masjid around a person whose hands were disfigured and whose feet were disfigured. And when I came close to this man, he said, Oh Abu Musa Ashari, go away. And I thought, how did this man know me? And he said, You may not know me, but I know you. He said, I am the man who pierced Uthman radiallahu anhu with a knife. And Uthman cursed me. And look at my hands and look at my feet. For Uthman ibn Affan, nothing else other than the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give witness. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep us united in this dunya, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reunite us in Jannatul Firdaws. Subhanakallahumma.